We are exploring the early years of JavaScript security, or I guess browser client-side security in general. And in this video, I want to explore a time frame of about 3 years from around 97 to around 2000. And I call it the Age of Universal XSS. But what does it mean? As you know, cross-site scripting, XSS, is a modern term. It was not a term used by anybody before the year 2000. But we are looking back from the future. And what we call today Universal XSS, which we see very rarely today, it was the norm back then. But what exactly does Universal XSS mean? I imagine many of you know about basic XSS, like reflected or stored XSS. But the first time I heard about Universal XSS, I couldn't quite grasp what that means. But I think all of this becomes clearer when we look back in time at these early vulnerabilities. So let's boot up Windows 95 and forget the term cross-site scripting and Universal XSS for now, because in 1997, nobody knew these terms. Let's go. A few months after the release of JavaScript in Netscape 2.0, around 96-97, they realized it's a bad idea when a website can use JavaScript to access cookies or data from another website. So they implemented a restriction. Today we call it the same origin policy. We talked about this already in the first episode of the series. But like with many security fixes, especially in a very, very complex environment like websites and browsers with tons of crazy features that were developed at light speed, there were always issues that broke that security barrier. But enough of Netscape for now, because Internet Explorer also joined the scene with their implementation of JavaScript called JScript. They released it a few months after Netscape and had similar issues. Look at this email by Aleph1. I think this is the same Aleph1 with the famous Smash the Stack for Fun and Profit article. So even the cool binary exploitation hackers back then dabbled in this new area of security. So here Aleph shares information about an issue reported by German hacker Ralf Hüskes of Jabadoo Communications. His findings are part of a series for the CT Computer magazine. Crazy to think that magazines back then were interested in such vulnerability research. Anyway, in a follow-up email, we can find the actual vulnerability code, because apparently Microsoft forced Ralph to remove the code. And it's a super short payload. Here we have an iframe, so it embeds another page, and the page it embeds is a file from the local system again. After the iframe loaded the file, it takes the HTML code off the embedded page and displays it. Does this vulnerability sound familiar? This is super interesting to me because this is essentially the same issue we looked at in the first video. So basically, the same issue happened in Netscape's JavaScript implementation a few months prior to that. I mean, it's not necessarily a JavaScript issue, it's a design and architecture issue. This issue arises from the fact that suddenly websites have JavaScript. But I guess news didn't travel to Microsoft yet, and so they had the same issue. Obviously, if you try to do this today, it doesn't work. The same origin policy tells us that one site cannot access the content of another site. But here in Internet Explorer version 4, this still worked. Now, let's have a look at a more interesting Internet Explorer vulnerability. In September 1998, Georgi Guninski found a bug that allows reading local files. Down here is the JavaScript. It's essentially only two lines, but it looks a bit more complicated. So it starts by opening a new window containing a local test file. And the real magic happens in this navigate call. Window.navigate is an old Internet Explorer function to open a website URL. Nowadays we would use window.location instead. So now we load a new URL in this window and it's a JavaScript URL. So this will execute the JavaScript here, which again opens a new window with the target file and simply extracts the text of it and shows it with an alert box. It's kind of straightforward what happens here. JavaScript URLs don't actually redirect to a new page. The JavaScript gets executed on the current site. This is actually still true in 2022. Here I have Chrome, and when I enter a JavaScript URI and to alert the current domain, you can see we execute JavaScript in the context of this site here. But the small detail that makes this a vulnerability in the old Internet Explorer is that an attacker can automatically trigger in the context of the current loaded site, which is a file URL. So by the same origin policy, it is allowed to access this file now. As you can see, researchers had to slowly find more and more tricks to break the security. But that was not a problem for Georgi. Georgi is a hacker who had his debut on the BugTrack mailing list in 1997 with an exploit for the mount process, a very long LC message environment variable caused a buffer overflow in mount. Look at this exploit written in C. Clearly he knows his stuff. But in 1998 he started to shift focus on breaking browsers. He reported several bugs to Netscape and eventually started to dig into Internet Explorer. Look at all these Microsoft security bulletins acknowledging Georgi. MS-99-12, a particular malformed URL could be used to execute scripts in the security context of a different domain. MS-99-37, it is possible for a website to invoke this method, bypass this restriction and write files that could be used to execute system commands. MS-99-40, a server-side redirect can be used to bypass a restriction, thereby enabling a malicious website operator to read files on the user's machine or the user's local intranet. This list just goes on and on. Georgi reports issue after issue in Internet Explorer, tons of them in 1999 and the year 2000. His motivation, you wonder? Looking at his resume, maybe it's because he hated Microsoft. I avoid using Microsoft products. Which is funny because his security work is really, really important, free work for Microsoft. But I guess at the time it felt like hurting them. So let's look at another Georgi bug. For example, this one from January 2000. Internet Explorer 5 security vulnerability circumventing cross-frame security policy and accessing the DOM of old documents. I have Windows 98 here with Internet Explorer 5, so let's visit the test page. It tells us that we should create a test file so we can test the file access, and I have here a test.txt. Then it opens this text file in a new window and another alert appears. Just need to wait a moment apparently. All right, we close this again. And there we have it. We have an alert with the content of the file, proving us that JavaScript was able to access the content of the local file. So what happened? The script opened the file in a new window. And then 2 seconds later, it clicks this image.2.html link, but it has target victim. So actually the site where the file is loaded is redirected to this new page. And then this new page loads an image with the JavaScript URI, and this JavaScript code calls window open with another JavaScript URI, where apparently it is now allowed to access the document body and text of the loaded file. At first, I thought somehow we get JavaScript execution again in the context of the file URI, but actually something else happens. Let's see how Georgi describes the bug. This is a strange exploit. If you open a new document in a window that contains an old document, the old document's DOM may be accessed by the new document until the new document is completely parsed and displayed. So sounds like there is a race condition happening. Looks like Internet Explorer keeps the old documents until the new document is finally parsed and displayed. So if you put an image source JavaScript in the new document, it has access to the old document's DOM. Ah, I think I get it. So an alert is like a breakpoint. JavaScript execution stops at this point until the user clicks OK. So let's go through it again. The file test.txt is opened in a new window, and then we redirect this window to a new page. This page starts parsing and encounters an image. This image URL now has to be loaded, so this triggers this JavaScript. And this JavaScript opens another window which will execute some more JavaScript and also executes an alert, at which point the site freezes while the JavaScript code on the new open window can still execute. And this JavaScript code then goes through the opener, so back to the window that opened it, to the body and the inner text. And this is the race condition. This new image2HTML site has not finished loading yet because this alert is still hanging, waiting for the user to click OK. So following the opener back, we don't get the image2HTML site, we get the previous DOM, the old document's DOM, so the local file. Absolutely insane that somebody came up with this over 22 years ago. What a legend. And actually, I only know about Georgi because during my research into the history, I actually had the opportunity to talk to David Ross, who was working at Microsoft during that era, and he told me about Georgi. At the time, Georgi was the primary finder of cross-domain bugs. In our conversation, he just keeps praising Georgi for the crazy work he did back then, and it actually had a huge impact on Microsoft, Internet Explorer, and security history. But more on that next video. For now, let's circle back to the title of the video. What do all these security bugs we looked at, and all the other dozens and dozens of bugs Georgi and of course others have discovered, have in common? Well, they are all about bypassing what people at the time, especially Microsoft, started to call cross-frame policy, cross-frame vulnerabilities, and so forth. The term kind of sounds similar to two terms we use today, the same origin policy and cross-site scripting. But we are not there yet. So up until the year 2000, the browser security world was all about the cross-frame vulnerabilities. As you now know, these were bugs in the browser itself that allowed malicious website to somehow access another site through another frame or window. A common example target for a proof of concept exploit was stealing local files, but of course, this applies to any other website as well. Instead of stealing a local file, one could have loaded another website and accessed that content. And that's what Universal XSS is about. Universal because it's a vulnerability that applies universally to every website because it has nothing to do with the website. It's a vulnerability in the browser. I think that's why the term Universal XSS is so confusing, because when you learn about XSS, you learn about XSS issues in websites. But clearly, we are talking here about vulnerabilities in the browser itself. I hope this makes it clearer to you what Universal XSS means and why it's so much rarer to find nowadays. It would be a very critical security bug in a browser. Now forget the term XSS again, because in the year 1999 and early 2000, the term cross-site scripting still didn't exist yet. Even though hackers were already exploiting the classic XSS vulnerabilities in practice, it just didn't have a name. So in the next video, we finally look at the history of cross-site scripting.